Yes.
So we'll begin with the questions, Prajay.
Yeah.
So the first question for today is from the students of IIT BHU. If everything was created as we see it today, then why in eukaryotes splicing occurs that denotes RNA dominance and favors gradual evolution of multicellular organisms from single cellular species?
Okay. So first I will give a non-technical answer to a basic question that is underlying what you're saying, and then we can go into the technical details of this. There is a lot of assumptions over here. Firstly, if everything was created as it is existing now, I think that itself is a presumption that needs to be questioned. Because why is that? So, was everything created as it is? Certainly not. A time is a factor which causes changes. And in fact, time itself is, in the Vedic tradition, a manifestation of God. Kalosmi, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, time I am. And so, the universe is created in such a way, Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate, that it is, the universe is complete in itself. Complete means whatever is required for its sustenance is provided within the universe. So Adibhutam Ksharo Bhavaha. So one of the features of the universe is that it constantly keeps changing. The very nature, there are two realities, na sato vidyate bhavo, na bhavo vidyate satah. That there is one reality which never changes, and there another reality which never stays constant. So the material world is a reality that is constantly changing. So therefore, if we look at the scriptures themselves, if you look at the civilization described in the Mahabharata and the Bhagavatam, sorry, and the Ramayana, there are significant differences. So, although there are similarities, if you consider the role of women, Sita's role versus Draupadi's role. Draupadi is a much more assertive personality. Sita is a much more, she's also strong, devoted, but she's a laid-back personality. The interaction between demons and humans is much more in the Ramayana. The main war is between humans and demons. In the Mahabharata, it is between humans and humans. And there are demons on both sides. So the universe is in a constant state of flux. And so that is an ingrained feature within the universe. And not only does the universe keep changing, personalities keep changing, then the kind of people who live, they keep changing. So the Vedic scriptures talk about demoniac species roaming the earth. We don't see the demoniac species physically for present on the earth right now. So times change, and the bodies that we have, they are basically like clothes. So now, as the cosmic seasons change, different clothes are available, suitable and available at different times. And accordingly, certain species may become more prominent, some species may become less prominent. So change is very much there within nature. And change is, in fact, if you consider one of the skills that Krishna learned among the 64 skills was interplant breeding, or plant breeding where he brings together different species for the purpose of improving them. So in that sense, change is a constant feature of the universe, and change is itself indicative of the self-sufficiency of the universe. Just like we have, say, speech recognition softwares now. Now, there can be a speech recognition software with a fixed vocabulary. So there are certain words it recognizes, certain words it doesn't recognize. So now, I used to use a speech recognition software. So whenever I would say the soul is Sat Chit Ananda, it is not a speech recognition software. It was a text-to-speech software. So for example, if I've written an article, The Soul is Sachit Anand. So it will read it out. Now it can read English. It can't read Sachit Anand. So it was reading it as The Soul is Saturday Chit Anand. S-A-T, it was translating as Saturday, reading it out as Saturday. Then as the software evolved further, then when it gave me as a facility to put in some words within it, and then it could read as Sachit Anand, I gave it the pronunciation, started reading it that way. So the point I'm making is that if a software has certain capacity to do some things, that itself requires intelligence. If a software has the capacity to learn, not just at the beginning it learns, but throughout it keeps learning, then that requires even greater intelligence. In fact, many of my friends work in Silicon Valley now. And when they design these softwares, which are continuously learning, they're artificial learning softwares, they're continuously learning. And to make them requires hundreds of times more intelligence than softwares which just have a static learning program, or which have like a fixed vocabulary or a fixed learning capacity. That's, they learn things right at the beginning and they do those things. So they can speak certain words or they can recognize certain words when spoken by us. But if a software can learn as it goes on, so if a software used in India by Indian, say a speech recognition software, it's repeatedly used in India by an Indians, it starts recognizing Indian accent. If it is used in Australia, it may be English itself, but it starts recognizing Australian accent. So the point is the learning capacity of a software as it goes along, that indicates greater intelligence among the programmers. Similarly, if nature exhibits certain learning capacities, so whichever be the specific mechanism by which it happens. So if, as we talk about survival of the fittest, which was a principle talked by Darwin, but it is not, that principle itself is indicating the resilience of nature. And that is just an observation, which is an important observation, but it indicates not just the intelligence of Darwin in observing it, it indicates the intelligence that has been infused in nature. So if physics reveals the glory of the divine intelligence in making certain immutable laws of nature, say for example, the laws of physics, laws of thermodynamics, they're immutable. Then biology reveals the intelligence of the designing intelligence in terms of making mechanisms that keep learning that go along the way. So that nature learns is something which is pointing to the intelligence of the divine as manifested through the nature. So I would say that when it is said things were as they are, that presumption itself is questionable. What is as it is? That there are true truths. There is matter and there is spirit. Matter keeps changing constantly. It will change in form, it will change in, if you look at modern history also, just 500 years ago, 100 years ago, things keep changing. Now, in human history, things change relatively faster. In biological history, things may change slower. Now, the problem is when it is claimed that these changes disprove the existence of God, or these changes are used to reject the existence of God. Well, that is a very superficial interpretation of these changes, which is ungrounded in fact. When we see in nature has a self-learning capacity, that actually, if we compare nature with a software program, it requires greater intelligence. So that's the broad answer to this question without getting into the technicalities. If nature exhibits certain learning capacities, now the specific propositions of evolution, that is something which is best left to the scientists to research, to theorize, and to evaluate. But the basic principle, if nature exhibits learning capacity, that indicates, that could very well indicate the intelligence of the designing intelligence who has infused nature with that capacity to learn. Does it answer your question?
Yes, Prabhu. Very, very broadly you could explain that. Thank you. The next question is from students from Gita Life, Bangalore. Proji, my question is, can a person time travel by being very close to the event horizon near black hole, or even enter into a spiritual realm, or better say some higher planetary system or parallel universe by entering into it? If we someday, hopefully, we can construct some machine or do that in near future, because in Srimad Bhagavatam, we can get direct evidence about time dilation in Brahma Vimohan Leela, where we see Brahma, after stealing calves and cowherd boys, went away for a moment to test Supreme Lord while 1 year had passed on Earth. And when he returned on the same time scale, only a moment had passed for him. That is around 4 hours as per calculation. So time being a very important factor is all relative. Isn't it possible to construct a wormhole or enter into that distant future or surpass the entire length of the universe?
Okay, these are big questions. Let's see. Could we travel through time at specific locations, say through wormholes or near black holes? We do see some kind of relativity of time within the Bhagavatam also, with say Brahma Vimohan Leela. Okay. So I'd like to divide this question into three broad parts. First is the concept of time. Second is the concept of relativity of time or time travel as it's explained in the Bhagavatam. The third is we'll look at what science says and how it applies in today's world with respect to our prospects. So first of all, you know, time is something that we constantly think about and we also rarely think about. What I mean by that is we are very conscious of time. I don't want to waste my time. I have this much time and I have to get this much work done. So there are a few things we are as conscious of practically as time. Because, you know, it matters enormously to us. Still, philosophically, there are few things that we are as we think of as rarely as time. Because what exactly is time? Philosophically speaking, you know, all that we know is time as it is measured through our time measuring devices. Can we even conceive of time independent of its measurement? So we said that, okay, time is moving from, it is 2:55 now, in 10 minutes it will be 3:05. So that's what we measure time in terms of its quantification. But independent of its quantification, what is time? If all the clocks in the world were destroyed, still time would exist, but what would it be? So philosophically, the concept of time is one of the most elusive. So Einstein integrated time into one of the dimensions within science. That's why he had the continuum called space-time. But even Einstein recognized that time as a dimension is substantially different from other dimensions. Why? Because within time, within all other dimensions, we can travel backward. But we cannot travel backward as far as we know, as far as our experiences, within time. And philosophically, there's a standard paradox with respect to time travel. So if we go back into time, if person X goes back into time, at a time when the grandfather was not yet married, and they kill their grandfather, then there's no grandfather to get married, then there are no father, then would you exist? So if we go back and change time, then so time travel conceptually into the past is riddled with logical improbabilities, logical perplexities at least. So my point is that time itself is a very complex concept. Now, having recognized this point, that all that we in our day-to-day in day-to-day actions and and awareness, what we think about is the measurement or quantification of time, not time itself. Then let's look at the Bhagavatam. Now the Bhagavatam talks about relativity of time in terms of how time flows differently at different places. Now, what is the purpose of this variability of the passage of time? There are many things. In general, time is the force that brings about change. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna identifies one of those changes when he says that kalosmi lokakshay krut pravruddho. Time I am the destroyer of the worlds. So time does all three things. Time leads to the creation, time leads to maintenance, and time leads to destruction also. The time is basically the agent that brings about change in things. So in that sense, time is a defining characteristic of the material existence itself. So if we consider broadly this perspective, now what does change do? Change often, if things are unpleasant in our life, we hope that change will make things more pleasant. Or if change are all pleasant, then we feel, oh, change should not happen. Say if a boy and a girl in a relationship and the girl is very attractive, then it's said that when a man and a woman get married, the man hopes that the woman will never change, and the man woman hopes that the man will soon change. And both are disappointed. That means that the man hopes that the woman, she will always be as good looking as she is now. And that doesn't stay that way. And whatever personality quirks the woman thinks the man has, he hopes I'll fix it. But she finds she can't fix it. It's much more difficult than what it is thought. But the point is that when we have something enjoyable, and the passage of time often takes away that which is enjoyable. So when the Bhagavatam talks about the relativity in the flow of time, the idea is the heavens, the higher worlds, are places where greater enjoyment is available. And those who have done greater pious credits, they go and stay over there. So the slower passage of time over there provides greater facility for them to enjoy in various ways. Of course, they don't enjoy in completely licentious or sinful ways. They enjoy in ways that are according to whatever heavenly facilities are there. So the point is, there is a philosophical understanding of time, and there is a philosophical reasoning behind the variability in the flow of time or rate of flow of time. So slower passage of time means that we can savor each moment more and more. We can enjoy the good things of life more and more. That's why, and of course, those who are in higher planets, they don't want to enjoy sensually, but they want to enjoy more elevated pleasures. In Tapaloka, people enjoy doing austerities. That also gives them a sense of self-mastery and spiritual connectedness, and they enjoy that. So either way, the flow of time is associated with the underlying purpose of the universe with its multi-level existence. So in the Bhagavatam, the idea of the flow of time is, say that Brahmaji went up for just a few moments, and on the earth, many years had passed when he came back. So there is a significant amount of variability that serves a particular purpose. So now having understood this philosophy, now is there a time travel per se in the Bhagavatam? Well, there is travel between domains of time or domains of the universe where time travels at different places. Time travels at different paces in different places. It travels at a different pace. And there is travel between time domains. So is it time travel? Well, it is not exactly time travel in the way it is talked about in science fiction today. You could say, yes, people go from time zone A to time zone. Somebody may be now here, and they may be come back after 1,000 years, because they went to somewhere else and they came back and 1,000 years passed over there. So it's more like a cosmic travel between various levels of the cosmos that inadvertently leads to time travel. So the relativity of time is something which is talked about in scripture. Now if you consider time travel itself, as science talks about it today. So we need to understand that science and scripture, they offer different models of the universe. And different models means that they have different frames of analyzing things. Like yesterday I talked about when, say, Virat Kohli hits a sixer to win a match. So now we could talk about it in terms of the expert skill of the batsman. We could talk about it in terms of, you know, how strong, sturdy was the bat, and with what force the bat was moved, with what angle the ball came, what was the point of contact between the bat and the ball. We could talk about it in the laws of motion. So modern science talks about more of the mechanical aspects of the universe. Now, both are valid. Now, if somebody... Now, maybe the bat manufacturers or the batsmen or others may decide that, you know, maybe a heavier bat might help. Of course, it has a flip side to it. To carry that bat, move that bat requires more energy. But in some place, a heavier bat would mean better things. So we could tweak certain mechanical things to have a better effect. And there could be personal skills that could be improved. So both are possible. And the two could be separate domains that interact at particular times, at particular places. So both are fine. The important thing here is that it's not so easy to decide which frame of reference one is going to use. And once one starts using a particular frame of reference, that's, we will analyze everything that way. So we need to see that science is one domain of analysis, and scripture is offering another domain of reality to analyze from another different perspective. So there is no need to try to take concepts from scripture and apply them in science. If we want to do that, we have to do that very, very carefully. Very, very carefully. Like yesterday, I gave the example of scales of perception. How do we reconcile? Is that powder black, gray powder, or is it white and black granules? Well, there are different scales of perception because of which we are observing different realities. So similarly, the scientific conceptions of the universe, they are based more on, say, a mechanical perception of reality. And to give some examples of this point, yesterday I also mentioned about how relativity and quantum physics perceive the physical world very differently. So now, can we take concepts from quantum physics and apply them to relativity physics? Well, it's very difficult. If you're using relativity as an approach to deal with certain aspects of reality, that's what we need to do. And if we're going to use physics, we have to use physics. So relativity will use relativity. So we have to be careful about what we are doing and why we are doing it. So whether time travel in terms of technology to do that, whether that is possible, and there whether philosophically time travel is possible, they're two different questions. So philosophically, we understand that time is the energy of the Lord, and time is made in such a way that time moves irrevocably forward. Now, we can't, if we lose even one moment, we can't get it back. That no amount of technological advancement is going to change that. No. So even if we develop the biggest of technologies, no, we can't go back, say, before 9/11 and prevent the downfall of the Twin Towers. We can't go back and prevent to 1937 or 33 or whatever and prevent the event that led to the Holocaust and the Second World War. So certain things have happened. So in general, going back to the past philosophically is riddled with a lot of problems. Now, technology, what kind of technology we may be able to develop and what we all will be doing with that, that is something which is up to the researchers to develop. And so much of what is called as time travel in fiction, that is, although it is scientific term, technologies seem to be used for that, but it is fiction. So now when scientists talk about at particular areas of the universe, near wormholes or wherever, there is a particular way in which we might be able to travel from one universe to another. Well, these are very technical scientific constructs. and how exactly they will be translated into any kind of working technology, much of advanced, that is very much open to question, much of advanced physics, particle physics, it is so abstract that to connect it with our day-to-day reality itself is very difficult. So I would say that from a spiritual perspective, there are certain domains which are, you remember I talked about the three circles. Spiritual knowledge is about transcending a material existence. And so there are certain domains which are specialists, which are the specialties of particular branches of knowledge. So depending on how that knowledge, that particular branch of knowledge advances, what it will be able to do, that is up to that branch of knowledge. It is not that spirituality offers is a guiding vision of what to use which knowledge for, but how exactly that knowledge develops, that will be up to the researchers and pioneers of that field. And last point I would like to make here is that in general, we need to recognize that everybody needs to recognize what is every branch of knowledge needs to recognize its area of competence. So there is material knowledge and there is spiritual knowledge. So material knowledge provides functionality in the world. Spiritual knowledge gives us a sense of purpose in the world. And the two have their own domains. And both branches of knowledge need to respect each other's domains. If we consider the Bhagavad Gita itself, after the Bhagavad Gita was spoken, Arjuna fought the Kurukshetra war and won the war. Now, what was the basis of Arjuna's victory? Was it the knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita, or was it the knowledge of archery that he had learned throughout his life? Well, it is both. It is not that his Bhagavad Gita knowledge replaced or substituted for his archery knowledge. Not that his archery knowledge substituted or replaced his Bhagavad Gita knowledge. So archery, his knowledge of archery helped him, taught him how to fight. And his knowledge of Bhagavad Gita told him why to fight. Not just why to fight, but why to live. What is the purpose of living? So broadly, if you understand there are different domains of knowledge, you know, even if we develop some mechanisms for time travel, you know, what are we going to do with that? What is the purpose of life? That knowledge is what spirituality provides. Spirituality provides answers to the why question. Why am I living? What is the purpose for which I should use whatever knowledge and resources I have? The hows science can provide, different technologies can come up and they can do different things. So we don't have to necessarily turn towards spirituality to find answers to scientific questions. And we don't have to turn towards science to find answers to spiritual questions. We need to recognize there are different domains. Now, how to shoot a Brahmastra or how to break the Chakravyuh, Arjuna does not refer to the knowledge of to the Bhagavad Gita for that answer. Bhagavad Gita he turns to for what is dharma? What is the purpose of living? What is the right thing for me to do in my life? So if you understand that different domains of knowledge have their respective areas of speciality, and at one level, spirituality is one domain of knowledge. At another level, we could say spirituality is the knowledge that underlies and guides all domains of knowledge. So whether it is medicine, whether it is high energy physics, whether it is microbiology, whether it is biotechnology, whatever it is, if we see that spirituality can give us a bigger vision of what to use that knowledge for, then we can better understand what questions will be answered through scientific development and what questions will be answered through spiritual advancement. Does that answer your question?
Yes, Prabhuji. So in the same context, actually, the question is that as you were mentioning that in the past, it is difficult to go because if we change that, that becomes difficulty. So the understanding is we can go if there is a concept of time travel, which you told also is like little vague and not clearly understandable now. So the question that has come up from the Geeta Live Bangalore students is if time travel, anyways, theoretically also is possible, is it possible to go in future only? That is their question.
Yeah, that would be the general understanding, because we cannot change the events that have happened. So I would say going into the back would be extremely difficult.
Okay. Yes, please. The next question is from Lucknow. The question is, how demons look like in Vedic times, and why don't we see them now in Kali Yuga?
Okay. What do demons look like? I don't think they have any specific forms. There are, if you look at the Mahabharata, the Ramayana itself, demons are much more prominent in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. Well, we have Ravan who could manifest 10 heads, who could also function with one head. We have Mahakaya and Atikaya, who seem to have huge bodies, as is as Kumbhakarna. And then we have other demons who seem to have more normal forms, normal in terms of a human reference. So is it that now Ravana is not considered normally at all an ugly looking person? So sometimes we have the idea of demons as having some kind of horns coming out of their heads, or some kind of fangs coming out of their mouths. But that's more of a stereotype or a caricature. Some demons may be like that, but some may not be. Maricha, who we see in the Mahabharata as a person who is basically a sage. And he appears like a sage, he behaves like a sage. So, and his form is like any other sage at that time. So was it that his form changed irreversibly? Before he was a demon, he had a different form and he got this form. That's what he took constantly. Well, demons have shape-changing abilities, but the shape that they change into, they're temporary usually for the particular purpose. Then they usually change back to their usual forms soon. So I would say that it's not that demons have one particular kind of biological form. So some demons may be permanently in certain species. They may have forms like of some ferocious animals. Sometimes they assume this form. Sometimes they may have those forms permanently. So I don't see demons as having a particular form necessarily as far as the description in scripture goes. Now, why aren't they visible? Presently, yes. Kali Yuga is an age where there is already a lot of contamination because of the increase in impurities. So now the universe itself is multi-level, and the changes, Satyuga, Treta Yuga, Dwapara Yuga, Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga comes primarily on the earth. At other places in the universe, time moves differently. So primarily this Kali Yuga comes on earth. And because the earth is very contaminated during Kali Yuga, usually two things happen. First is at a gross level, there is a kind of quarantining of the earth from the rest of the universe, so that the effects of Kali don't spread elsewhere. Just like currently the pandemic, much international travel has been suspended. Many countries have closed their borders. So like that, the Earth's borders are more or less sealed. So the interplanetary or even interuniversal travel, that is with respect to the Earth, it's cut down substantially. And secondly, the demons, when they come in, they may often come in subtler forms. In the Mahabharata itself, we don't see so many demons because in physical form, there are a few like Alambush and Ghatotkach and few others, but they're not as prominent as in the Ramayana, because what has happened is Mahabharata just at the start of Kali Yuga, toward the end of the previous age, And by this time itself, the demons had started penetrating in subtler ways. That means Duryodhan himself was like a progeny of the Daityas and Danavas who had come to the earth through earthly wombs. So there are many demoniac people. So we have had brutal tyrants, who dictators, autocrats, who have killed thousands and even millions of people. So they're not much different from demons of the past. So the demons may come in subtler forms, but overall, because of the toxic effects of Kali, there is a quarantining, and that's why we don't experience so much the other domains of reality in Kali Yuga. Any other questions?
Yes, Praji. This question is from RBC Bangalore, students from RBC Bangalore. Praji, advancement in biology today had allowed us to sequence the DNA of any species. Sequencing has led to discoveries in the similarities we share with other species. For example, by sequencing the genome, it is being proven that chimpanzees have 48 chromosomes while humans have 46, and the second and third chromosome of the chimpanzee, when fused together, forms another second human chromosome and is identical to it. Similarly, we share genetic traits with birds too. Example, both birds and humans produced a yolk sac. The yolk sac provides the medium for the bird in the end. And in the mother's womb also, a yolk sac is produced, but it disappears in the early stages. By sequencing the genome, they have found the similar genes in birds and humans which produce yolk sac. Link of this video is given for reference.
Okay.
Using these evidences, biologists are promoting the theory of spontaneous evolution, that diverse species emerged from a common ancestor by changes in our genomes. I wish to clear the fact that I do not reject the origin of universe and the life on earth as given by scriptures. I actually feel that the proof mentioned above actually supports scriptures. My question is, whether these similarities in genomes date back to the common father of all earth, that is Maharshi Kashyapa, as given in the scriptures, who gave birth to several species with 13 wives. Is the common ancestor referred in biology as, in fact, Maharshi Kashyapa himself?
Okay, good question. So 2-3 points. Firstly, the genome sequencing that we have done, that shows remarkable similarities between humans and chimpanzees. So, and you talked also about yolk. So that's, I will not go into the specifics right now. We could discuss about that at some other time. So there are 2-3 different things. See, evolution itself, the word can be understood at 3 different levels. Evolution is at one level, simply modification in species, which is observed. So we have observed various things. Say we can interbreed and make apples very big. We can have dogs which are like small poodles, dogs which are Dobermans. So now basically, through the interbreeding of species, that things can be changed. That this is through, and one way it's through manually, we could do it through manual breeding. And similarly, within nature, species change. So evolution at one level can refer to observed change in nature. There is no disputing that. That's just evidence. It's there. Now the question is, what explains this? So evolution can refer to the first is this, observed changes in nature. Second is, evolution can refer to the mechanisms that bring about this change. So that is, so natural selection is considered the most prominent mechanism, but now scientists have come up with other mechanisms. They talk about genetic mutation. They also talk about sexual selection is also coming up as another mechanism which brings about changes. So now, that's the second level understanding of evolution. That is the mechanism that brings about the changes that are observed in the universe. So we'll come back to the validity of this little later. The third level of understanding of the evolution is as a all explaining ideology, where evolution is used by atheists to reject the existence of God, to reject the existence of any higher realities beyond the material. So this third level evolution, so evolution as observation, evolution as mechanism, and evolution as ideology. You can answer these three levels, understand, keep these three levels in mind. The real issue for spiritualists is when evolution is used as an ideology, that everything that exists in nature and everything that has come about, it all can be explained through evolution. Well, no matter how many technicalities the theory of evolution comes up with, origin of life and origin of consciousness remain extremely difficult to understand. A prominent physicist says that about all that we know about consciousness is that it seems to be more associated with the brain than with the toe. You know, what is consciousness? Where does it come from? This is one of the biggest problems in the current scientific study. And so that has definitely not been explained. So our primary issue is with when evolution is used by as an ideology to reject the existence of God, or to make science seem antitheistic. So this is definitely, we cannot agree with evolution as ideology. And when evolution is treated as ideology, it is actually not science. It is, as its ideology means, it's a philosophical claim masquerading as science. So evolution itself is a mechanism. So in that, if now evolution, to the extent it is vindicated by scientific research, to that extent, if it is a mechanism, it will be a mechanism like gravity. So now gravity itself does not disprove God. Gravity is a mechanism by which things, physical objects interact with each other. Evolution could be a mechanism by which biological objects interact with their environment and adapt accordingly. Now, how true the specific theories about evolution are, that is something which is open to discussion. So there has to be a serious scientific investigation of particular theories. And the mainstream scientists more or less accept the theory of evolution. When they accept the theory of evolution, what do they do usually? They have observed changes. But based on those observed changes, they conclude that certain mechanisms are the best explanations for those observed changes. Mm-hmm. So there is a small but significant body of scientists who feel that for all the changes that have been observed in nature, the proposed mechanisms are not adequate. So that is an ongoing debate in the scientific community. And we don't need to get into the specifics of those debates. So do we accept evolution as an observed change? Obviously. Do we accept evolution as an ideology? Certainly not. Do we accept evolution as a mechanism? Maybe. That's not, as I said, that study of nature is done in the Bhagavatam primarily for reminding us of the Lord who is beyond nature. Study of nature primarily to understand the technicalities of all its mechanisms, that is not the purpose of spiritual texts. So that is not the purpose. So what specific mechanisms are there? Newton's law of gravity and laws of motion, the principle of gravity is talked about in the tradition of Indian physics, long before gravity was talked about by Newton. But that is the material knowledge that was developed in parallel with the spiritual knowledge that was given in the scriptures. So there is no need to put the two in competition. And now specifically, could the common ancestor be one of the progenitors? Well, generally, when we are taking two domains of knowledge and trying to establish correlations between them, there has to be a lot of serious research to be done. So what you're saying could be a possibility, but I wouldn't make a direct claim about it. It's like if I have two maps, if I have the physical map of India and I have the political map of India, both of them are depicting India, but they're two different perspectives. On the political map, all the state boundaries will be there. On the physical map, maybe, okay, this is a plateau, this is a hill, this is a plain, this is a mountain range, this is a river, that will be more prominent. So now, can the two be correlated to maps? Yes, they can be, but one has to do it carefully. One has to understand both the maps carefully, get some understanding of the territory, of the reality that is both the maps are pointing toward, and then bring about a correlation between the two. Similarly, there are devotee scientists who are doing serious study of evolution and other current scientific domains of knowledge. And they're also doing serious study of scripture. And then some kind of correlation between these two maps can be brought about. Now, as far as specifically the genomes between different species being similar, that again does not in any way that can lend itself to multiple metaphysical interpretations. So that is an observation. Generally, whenever we have an observation, what explains that observation, that something which is, what is the explanation that we use for that observation, that's open to question. So imagine if there will be some organizing principle underlying the world who shaped various species, then is it necessary for that underlying that organizing intelligence to design entirely different models for every species? If we have a sculptor who's going to make different sculptures, or if we have a potter who makes wheels, or somebody who makes busts, they might make one model and they may vary the model. And that would be a more efficient way of doing it. So similarly, if we have one basic genome model, and there are variations within that for different species. So the very fact that the similarity similarity at the genome level in terms of different species, in terms of genetic content, that doesn't in any way prove that there is no organizing principle underlying what is happening. So yes, now specifically, what is that organizing principle, how it organizes, and how those realities relate with what are the descriptions of scripture? That's something which requires serious investigation. Does it answer the question?
Yes, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, the next question is from the students of IIT Kharagpur. Prabhu, you mentioned both scientific and Vedic version of universe are valid in their domain. I didn't understand how can they be simultaneously valid, as one describes universe coming from a singularity and the other from Mahavishnu's body.
Okay. I mentioned this, how exactly are quantum physics and relativity both true? Well, physics doesn't know. It's one of the biggest and most perplexing unanswered questions in physics. So am I saying that specific scientific theories are true? That's not my point. My point is that when we approach reality from different views, we will see things differently. So whether the Big Bang theory itself is true or not, the Big Bang theory has itself been developed and expanded into various other, there are Big Bang and Big Crunch, and there are many other theories that have come up. So rather than getting into the specifics of the theories, the point is that science has a way of looking at the world, and a scientific way of looking at the world has its value and validity, and there's a scriptural way of looking at the world, and that has its value and validity. So now, specifics of how exactly which worldviews, which detail correlates with which worldview, another worldview, which detail, that is something which we will have to carefully discuss, carefully analyze. So if the universe comes from a singularity, now what exactly is the nature of that singularity? Could that singularity be the unmanifest pradhan? Maybe, maybe not. We don't know that. It's not that the two are two ideas are irreconcilably different. That is, one is a mechanical view of the universe. The other is a more personal view of the universe. So from a personal perspective, the universe comes from the body of Mahavishnu, from his bodily pores, and it expands. So for someone who doesn't have spiritual vision, imagine if we existed in some kind of trans-universal space at the start of the universe, or at the, whenever the universe started coming into existence, would we be able to literally see Mahavishnu's body and pores coming out from that body, some things coming out of the pores and then expanding? What would we see? Well, we don't know. You know that even, like I mentioned earlier, even now, if we go to the, if say the beings, celestial beings such as the god, devatas, they come to the earth, we may not be able to see them now. So say, for example, in the Bhagavatam, there is a description that from certain progenitors, wives or daughters, various species came out. Now, what does that mean? Now, we can't have a very naive understanding. Means if at that time we were there, would we literally see snakes and various species dropping out of the body of those particular celestial beings? Things are subtle, things are complicated. So we would be able to perceive things according to our scale of perception, our level of adhikar. So science perceives realities in a particular way. The spiritual texts describe the reality in a different way. Can the two be reconciled? Possibly. It will require a significant amount of research. But that is something which those who are interested in that field, they can do it. So we have to understand, why am I studying science and why am I studying scripture? And based on that, we adopt a pragmatic approach for moving forward in our life. So as I said, we use science for functioning in the world, for gaining resources for functioning in the world. And we use spirituality for understanding what is the purpose of life, what is the purpose of whatever we are ultimately doing, and we function accordingly. So in Ayurveda, for example, it is understood that Vishnu through Dhanvantari is the curative principle. But that didn't stop the Ayurvedic researchers from looking for specific mechanical explanations for specific diseases, coming up with mechanical cures. Mechanical cures means, okay, if you're having this disease, that means, you know, there's this kind of imbalance in your body, and this is what you need to fix it. That's what you need to do, fix it. So if we consider it's mechanical, what the Ayurveda describes, okay, your kapha has become too much in your body, okay, eat this, 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 and you'll feel better. The pitta has become too much, okay, eat this, this, and it will become better. That's how it is. So the mechanical view of reality has utility. The personal view of reality has its utility. Specific theories that have come up with the mechanistic or mechanical view of reality, true. Well, let scientists evaluate those theories, and let scientists find out what is the best explanation for what they observe. And then those who are serious spiritualists, or those who are scientifically interested spiritualists who want to bring about a dialogue between the two of them, let them find out exactly which theories correlate with which scriptural statements and what way. Okay.
Yes, Praji. So the same student who had asked one of the previous questions is asking that, Praji, please guide us as how we must proceed as engineers and scientists using science as a tool to support our spirituality. Is it possible to lead people into spirituality using science? How can we contribute to science in such a way that people realize it, that people realize it does point towards the supreme creator, the supreme personality of Godhead?
Okay. That's a very good question. So, how can we, say as scientists or as engineers, use our scientific studies to, say, raise spiritual awareness among people? I'd say there are 3-4 different levels. First is by our conduct itself. Now, if we behave responsibly, if we behave, function competently, people are attracted. So we need to do our activities diligently and competently, respond as much as we can, and that will attract people, whether it is studies or whatever job we do. That's the first thing. Second thing is that through engineering, whatever position we acquire in society, we can use it to use the respectability that comes from that position to get people to connect with Krishna. So you could, say ordinary person talks about something spiritual, and somebody is very well educated. Now, most of you are from the best engineering colleges in India. So if you invite your friends, your relatives, to maybe read a Bhagavad Gita, to read some spiritual article, to attend a talk, to visit or come for a festival, they will take that much more seriously. So first is that just by your conduct, you interact and attract people, and they themselves will ask, how do you function? What makes you tick? Second is you go beyond that and you specifically invite. Third is that maybe you, once you get enough training, you might yourself be able to write or speak and share spiritual wisdom with others. So that would be that would be something very significant, because if you yourself are teaching it, then people will be attracted. No, rather than you just inviting people to come for talks, you will become learned and you teach that. And spiritualists who are grounded in science can be a great asset to society, because the rational presentation of spirituality is one of the greatest needs in society today. And beyond that, now within your specific area of research, how can that area of research be connected with spirituality? For that, you may need to contact specialists in particular fields. There are several areas where spirituality can actually come in contact with the current science. So one of the biggest areas is consciousness studies. Now, consciousness studies can come in consciousness studies through neuroscience, through psychology and cognitive behavioral therapy and mindfulness and things like that. It can come in through artificial intelligence. It can come in through that direction, through the philosophy of science. So I would say that I have a whole separate talk on artificial intelligence, what it can do, what artificial intelligence implies. But the point is that there are many areas, among the various areas where science and spirituality interact, consciousness is one of the most promising in terms of its potentiality. Consciousness was a taboo subject almost 15-20 years ago because it was just so incomprehensible. But now the explosion of research in the field of consciousness, and especially in terms of applied principles, there is mind-body medicine and spiritual care for patients of those who want end-of-care treatment and stuff like that. That's also very prominent. So mind-body interaction, there is a lot that goes on in the name of scientific spirituality that is questionable scientifically and questionable spiritually also. But there is some amount of serious research also going on. that's also a domain where some research could be done. So, and something which is very relevant. So in general, science and technology, they will, spirituality has a philosophical aspect and spirituality is a pragmatic aspect. So the philosophical aspect of spirituality would not be something that science can ever reach, because there's a different domain of reality. But the pragmatic aspect, so for example, if we chant Hare Krishna, now whether Krishna is God, whether God is a bluish black cowherd boy, that is something which is beyond science to either prove or disprove. It's just beyond the domain of science. But if somebody meditates regularly, chants mantras, or does a particular kind of study, how it affects their brain, how it affects their behavior, that is something which can be studied. And there have been several promising studies about the effects of mantra meditation and other forms of meditation in reformulating the brain structures of people, as well as in reforming their behaviors. So that is also an area of research. So I would say that as you become more and more grounded in your spirituality by associating with devotees, if your areas of scientific research become more crystallized, then you could talk with devotees who are in specific research, who are doing scientific research, and find out which area you could specifically go into. Or if you don't have any clear sense of which area you want to go into research in future, then you could talk with devotees, like, and I gave some indications of some areas. You could talk with many devotees who are in scientific research, and then find out which will be an area of your interest. So for some people, science is their passion, or even technology, we could say, is their passion. And for many others, it is a profession. So you are interested in it, but it's not exactly like a passion for you. It's a profession in the sense that you like to do it. It's a job and you like to do it well, but that's not what constantly consumes your mind. So for those whom science or technology or your particular branch of domain is a passion, then you would love to go into research, and for you to find out some areas where science and spirituality intersect, and you do that research, that would be promising. For those whom it's a profession, and even as a profession also, you could do some research and find some interaction. But then you may not want to necessarily go into that domain, but still you could work at the, try to, so if it's primarily a profession, then you may be more concerned with what profession works best for your career goals and for your financial security and stability in future. And then you could function at the other three levels, through your conduct, through your contacts and invitations, and through your personally teaching, you could share spirituality. So does that answer your question?
Yes, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, there are questions which are similar. I'm clubbing them up, but I'll read it. The two questions are from students from IIT BHU and IIT Kharagpur. So I'll read 2-3 questions. It is having similar output, hopefully. So the question number one is, why the devotees are not raising the question that we want to go to the moon and ask for NASA to have some travel for all of us and let us reveal to the world that they are just bluffing on the name of moon landing? Another question in similar lines is, why we cannot go to moon planet now? Any scriptural reference? What is the scriptural understanding of eclipse and where it is mentioned in the scriptures?
Well, those who are asking the question about the moon, were you there for yesterday's class? I explained about the moon travel yesterday. So,
yeah, they were there, Prabhuji. On the basis of that, okay. They have asked, yeah.
So I don't see that as a major issue at all. Are scientists bluffing? Well, I mean, bluff is a very strong word to use. And Srila Prabhupada's point was primarily, don't get so excited. Okay, even if we go to the moon, what is so great about it? Prabhupada writes in the introduction of the Bhagavad Gita that we have endeavored a lot to raise ourselves to go to the moon, but we are not endeavored sufficiently to raise our own consciousness. So if we raise our consciousness, that will be much more productive than if we focus on going towards the, then humanity would be much happier. So the point is not to challenge science or its accomplishments. The point is to recognize the implications of those accomplishments. So even if we succeed in going to the moon, even if tomorrow we colonize the moon, what are we going to do over there? Now, if we are going to moon, and there also we are going to basically continue the pursuit of materialistic pleasures, we are going to simply get more space for eating, sleeping, mating, defending, then what is so great about it? So I would say that the moon issue is something which was, I have talked with devotees who lived in the six, who were in the youth in the 60s, and at that time the moon mission had captured the imagination of humanity like few other things. And it was that, you know, if humanity reaches the moon, then that's the greatest achievement. And that indicates the power of technology, and it shows that humanity can conquer any barriers and can solve all problems through science. Well, yes, maybe not. So that kind of hubris, where science is the answer to all problems, that is not there in humanity today. We do value science. Many of us are captivated by technology, but everybody understands today, almost every thoughtful person understands that science and technology and their advancement, they can help humanity in many significant ways, but they can't solve the fundamental questions of the fundamental problems of living. Even from a spiritual, not just from a spiritual perspective, even from a practical perspective. Technology, say, if there are poor people and maybe we use some farming methods to produce better crops, that will produce better grains, and that's good. But there are so many people who are corrupt. There are corrupt because they hold on to money. There are so many people who are addicted. They waste their money on alcoholism and all that. So can we find a pill that can cure people of greed and corruption? Can we give an injection by which people can become free from addiction? We understand that it's not that simple. So the point of Srila Prabhupada in critiquing the moon mission was to stress this point, that don't get carried away by the promises of science and technology. Science and technology can help humanity in many different ways, but it can't really answer life's ultimate questions. We, like I told you, make things better, spirituality can make people better. Science may be able to make the outer world better, spirituality can make our inner world better. And together, both can help make the world better. So we have to choose which battles we fight. You know, if say tomorrow we find irrefutable evidence that, suppose hypothetically, we find irrefutable evidence that scientists are able to go to the moon. So what? That doesn't change the fact that Krishna is God. That doesn't change the scriptural descriptions about the nature and purpose of life. So Prabhupada himself says that by mechanical spacecrafts also, by mechanical means also, people may be able to go to higher planets. It's rare, but it's possible. When in the Mahabharata, Arjuna is meditating in the Himalayas to do some austerities for gaining some special weapons for the upcoming Kurukshetra war. At that time, Indra sends a chariot. and the chariot comes with his charioteer Maithili, and then that chariot comes from the heavens and takes him to heavens. The chariot is a physical structure, and the physical structure goes from the earth to the heavens. But the difference is that, of course, that came from a higher domain of reality. Arjuna had performed austerities, and when he went to heavens, he was able to meet with the heavenly personalities in heaven. He was able to interact with Indra. So the point is that we need to not just obsess over specific statements, but we need to also look at the context within which those statements were made. So Prabhupada's point was, don't get so excited by the promises of science and technology and think that science and technology will ever make spirituality redundant. So, but just to recognize the value of spirituality, we don't have to dismiss science and technology. So there could be scientific arrogance where they think that we will make spirituality unnecessary. And there could be arrogance among spiritualists who think that science and technology is all useless. Well, arrogance or hubris is bad in any domain. In the domain of science, it is bad. In the domain of spirituality also, it is bad. So if we truly understand what our spiritual teachers are teaching, not simply by looking at their words decontextualized from the context of what they're speaking, but their words seen in the overall context of what they're saying, then we can humbly use science and technology, and we can humbly use spiritual knowledge, and we can become better human beings, raise our consciousness, and help others raise their consciousness. Okay?
Yes, Prabhu. There are lots of questions anyways. I'll see how much time. Yes, Prabhu. The next question is from students from SLV Pune. Prabhuji, yesterday you spoke about testometer, lovometer, pionometer, etc. We cannot define their intensity, but there are certain mathematical representations of qualities like golden ratio in painting, which makes painting look beautiful to look at, thereby relating quality or emotion to mathematics. So does this indicate that every other quality and emotions can be represented mathematically? We have just not reached to that level of mathematical advancement. For example, Professor Srinivasa Ramanujan, who communicated with his deity and the goddess, revealed to him the mathematical concepts about universal creations, which were unknown at that time.
Okay, good question. So, is it that we have still not developed the technology to, say, understand the qualitative aspects of the universe? Yes, certainly. We could develop more and more technology. And if we develop that, that's valuable, that's helpful. So, how well can technological advancement lead to appreciation of aesthetic qualities? Well, let's look at it this way. If we consider, say, Photoshop, if we want to make some image using Photoshop, then what can Photoshop do? It can give us access to a huge template of colors. It can also give us access to a wide variety of tools for changing the colors in many subtle and remarkably precise ways. And then, so basically what a painter might require, lots of times, put this paint dab out there. We can do it using, say, Photoshop much faster. So posters and stuff like that can be designed very well. And if somebody wants to do art also digitally, well, you can try it and it can provide us tools. At the end of it, the experience of art is a conscious experience. And the computer might be able to come up with certain programs which are based on certain studies of the past. But ultimately, the experience of how beautiful this is, that requires a conscious observer. Without the conscious observer can be provided tools for making things better. Say, for example, now one of my services is writing. All of us practically write, and we may use some tools like Grammarly, or there's so many other softwares for improving our English, which is great as far as those tools go. So we may not have to keep all the rules of grammar in our mind. And if we are making some mistake in a grammatical sense, the tool can tell us. Now, of course, we could say that if you go on the internet and search for, say, spell check errors or spell check jokes, you'll find many cases of how spell check can make a mess of things. And that kind of mess of things, as spell check also evolves, it can improve. So where it can improve, it is to be appreciated to the extent it has improved. Having said that, let's take one more thing. See, there is in writing as well as in painting, there is a craft aspect and there is an art aspect. Craft aspect means that there are mechanical aspects in writing. Say, for example, the grammar rules are mechanical. Okay, you know, this is a comma has to be put here, and this is the right word over here, that is not the right word over there. These are mechanical aspects. And the mechanical aspects can definitely be improved through technology. So even in painting, there is painting, we might call it as art, but painting has a craft aspect to it. And there's a craft aspect and there's an art aspect. So for example, if you really want to learn how to write, well, reading newspapers may not be very helpful. Why? Because newspapers don't depict writing as a art. It's writing as a craft over there. There are certain events that have happened and they're reported, and we learn something from that. But if you really want to learn writing as a skill, which is very, it's a skill in itself, then you have to read well-written books. That's writing. That's where you will see writing as an art. So the craft aspect with respect to the grammatical rules, and now when I'm saying grammatical rules, I'm in no way dismissing the importance of grammar. So, but there are certain rules which are subtler. Say, for example, don't use long sentences, or don't repeat the same word many times. Don't repeat the same word very close to the previous occurrences of that word. So a grammar checker can tell, okay, this word you have used in your article, in your book, this many times. That can be useful to analyze books. You can make word clouds with words to get keys and tags for your articles online, which is all helpful. But writing as an art, there's something which we read for information. There is some writing we read for aesthetic pleasure. It is so beautifully written. That is, suppose we see, when we are looking at a map, we are not looking for aesthetic pleasure when we are looking at a map. We are looking for functional value. So a map also requires drawing skill. But a map is primarily what? It's a work, it's an art, but it involves drawing. But it's primarily a craft. But if you're looking at a painting like Mona Lisa, well, we look at it itself from a different perspective. So mechanical tools or technology, artificial intelligence and other such advances in technology can provide us resources by which we could improve writing improve any craft, the craft aspect of any artistic skill with qualitative experiences. But the qualitative experience itself is something which requires the input of a conscious observer. So the two are significantly different domains. So yes, science and technology can provide us tools to improve even areas of art. And to the extent they are provided, that's great. At the same time, We need to recognize that each domain of knowledge has its particular thrust. So it's like asking, say, if we develop better and better binoculars, if we develop better and better telescopes, can the improvement of telescopes in the future enable a deaf person to hear? Well, and that's a wrong question to ask. A telescope is meant to enhance our power of seeing, not our power of hearing. So science itself focuses on the, as I said, the mechanical, measurable aspects of reality, and it can bring about some correlations between them. But when those mechanical, measurable aspects of reality come together, there is a certain aesthetic experience that is produced. And some things which you see, hey, okay, that's useful. And some, wow, what's that? It's a difference. So why is that difference there? Because there is a conscious experience and there are certain subtle things, subtle attributes in the observed object that produce this conscious experience. So what are those? What specifically produces that conscious experience? Well, these are subtle things. So yes, technology can definitely help us to improve the craft aspect of things, but the art aspect of things needs to be carefully, it requires conscious intelligence to do, conscious intelligence to do it, and it requires conscious intelligence to experience it. So that's why there are certain things which the qualitative aspects, again, the mathematical formula that bring about a certain qualitative experience, they may be noted and repeated through some technologies. But the conscious experience itself is a different domain of reality. So let's consider another example to illustrate this. Let's say if there is some chocolate, which is extremely delicious. Now, that taste of the chocolate is experienced in the tongue. Now, once the functionality is determined, okay, this is what is done, this is how this chocolate was made, then that functionality can be programmed and that can be repeated. So we could say that hundreds and thousands and even millions of chocolates could be produced, which give that similar aesthetic experience when people eat it. That's fine. But that aesthetic experience requires a conscious observer to experience it, a conscious experiencer. The machines that are doing it, they don't even know what they are doing. They're not experiencing what they are doing. They're simply doing what they are told to do. So there is a significant difference between the experience of qualities and the production of things that give us the experience of those qualities. So through technology, we might be able to mechanize and industrialize, in the sense of mass produce, the production of things that give us those experience. But the experience of things themselves is something which is distinct. Does it answer the question?
Yes, bro. There are three more questions. So should we take at least one or two or three?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Roji, we see that the technological advancements that has happened in the last three decades is really high. So why technological advancement did not happen in ancient time as of now? This is students from GGD, Pune.
Okay. Is there some particular technology you are talking about, or is it a generic question?
It's a generic question, Praja. But seemingly... Okay. AI and all that, maybe.
Yeah. So why did technology not advance in the past? Why did it advance now? Well, if we consider the last few centuries or in the last millennia or two, yeah, we do have had significant advances in technology. And that's also associated with a particular worldview. let me draw something over here to explain this. Okay, wrong device. Okay, I just draw visualize it over here. See, we human beings are here. The world around us is here.
Ruchi, if you want, you can use the share screen for using whiteboard.
That's what I'm thinking. Yeah, I also have extender for this. Okay.
Okay.
So let me see if I can. Yeah. So let's try this. So if we consider, okay, this is the conscious being, this is material nature around us, and then this is, we could say, the higher consciousness, the divine reality, is the ultimate reality, whatever. So this is the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita that talks about these three realities, that is nature, consciousness, and the supreme. So now, in the past, whether it was the East or the West, broadly the understanding was that this world, you are able to see what I'm doing? Hare Krishna?
Yes, Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu. We are able to see that.
Okay, so this physical physical or material reality that is there around us, so this was seen more or less as something which is temporary, and changing and improving this is also going to provide only some temporary benefits. So because of that, changing the temporary was not considered very important. What the overall worldview was, that the earth is temporary. Because it's temporary, better live here in a way that we can attain the eternal. That's why the focus was on establishing some connection between between matter and spirit. The focus was between consciousness and the infinite. Not so much so connection with the divine, connection with the spiritual was considered far more important than control of the material. So if we consider, it's not just India, but any part of the world, the focus was not so much on control of the physical. It was more on connection with the spiritual. Now, sometimes through connection with the spiritual also, we may get some control over the material. So connection with the, not just the spiritual, the higher realities. So for example, when there is technology that is described in the scriptures, so there were various kinds of astras. So how were there astras, there is a Brahmastra or Agni Astra or whatever, how were they got? They were got by, sorry. Yeah, they were got by connecting ourselves, like Arjuna performed austerities to connect with the higher reality. So Devatas and the Supreme Lord. And then, so Arjuna connected this way. And then through that, he got the power to control things. So he could summon storm weapons, he could storm air weapons, fire weapons, all those things. So the idea was, we connect upward here. And once we are connected upward, then through that upward connection, by the grace of the Devatas, we get power here. By the grace of Devatas or the grace of the Supreme Lord. And the technology that was described at that time, in many ways, it is very sophisticated and even far more precise than what we have now. So we have Arjuna, Ashwatthama sending a weapon which was targeted to kill the child in the womb of Uttara without hurting Uttara. We don't have weapons that precise, anywhere near that precise. when we have we have some missiles that we may shoot, there's so much collateral damage that happens. So this was the way technology was developed in the past. Whenever technology was there, that access the higher powers and by their grace get the power to control material nature. But as Kali Yuga started progressing, this connection with the higher domains started decreasing. We became more like a boxed reality. So we started losing connection with higher domains of reality. And then all that remained was we and matter. So matter and consciousness, that's what remained. Although there was some connection with the higher realities, there was definitely religion and worship, but the access to mystical powers through those forms of religion worship, that became lesser and lesser. And then the idea still remained, okay, we worship God and we maybe by worshiping God, some of the distresses in our life can decrease and ultimately we attain the kingdom of God. Since what is called as the Renaissance, the time of Renaissance in the Western technology, what happened was that the three major movements in Western intellectual history, we could say roughly correlate them. 16th century was Renaissance, 17th century was Reformation. Then the Scientific Revolution, and there was the Renaissance, the Reformation, Scientific Revolution. These three, they're not exactly sequential, but they are broadly in that sequence with some overlapping. So in Renaissance, what happened was that they felt that we don't just have to pass through this world. We can experience this world. We can study this world. We can depict this world. If we consider most of the art before the 16th century, there was no concept of art which simply depicted nature. Art was used to depict the sacred. And the sacred might be depicted in nature, but there was no concept of art that was independent of the sacred. But from Renaissance, what happened? Okay, let's study this world more and more. Then there was the Reformation, the Christian Reformation, which said that we don't want the control of religious institutions over our life. Even if you want to study religious texts, we will study them on our own. So what happened was, then there was a greater, and these are very complex historical movements, and I'm giving a very bare bones analysis of their effect. But the idea was, you know, we don't want our knowledge to be controlled by a certain priestly class. We will study and we will learn. And the Scientific Revolution was where they started studying and learning through nature, what are the mechanisms governing it and how we can use the knowledge of those mechanisms to control nature, to bend it to human will. So then in today's world, most technology is simply this way. No acknowledgement of any higher reality. There is no seeking access to that higher reality to get the power to control the lower reality. So there was technology 5,000 years ago or so before that, as is described in the Vedic texts. And there are, even this is not just a self-congratulatory description of the Vedic texts, there seem to be evidences of remarkably advanced technologies. There are remnants of those even today. The pyramids, how they were made, it's an architectural mystery. There are so many other architectural wonders that are there in different parts of the world which are so difficult to explain. So they had some kind of technology at that time, but they didn't have the mechanical vision of the universe, and they did not have the mechanical resources to operate, to develop the kind of technology we have developed today. So our vision of technology is simply we conscious beings interact with matter and try to control it. In the past, in the remote past, we could say thousands of years ago, it was that nature could be controlled through appeasing the higher powers who control nature. So that's why there, in the recent past, when we had lost access to the higher powers, we didn't see much technology. Now, as we are focusing more and more on trying to control nature using technology, we are developing technology more and more. But at the same time, we are realizing that it's not so easy or so simple to control nature. Because what happens when we try to control nature? Nature gets back at us. That's why the dominant ethos now, in the past, say 200, 300 years, we will bend nature to human will. But now there is increased environmental consciousness. and the recognition that we can't simply bend nature to human will. We have to live in cooperation with nature. And now we are trying to develop more eco-friendly technologies. So technology, rather than simply seeing it, a technological advancement, rather than seeing it simply as, you know, people in the past were primitive and now we are more intelligent, and that's why we developed technologies. That is one aspect of it. But another aspect is that what is considered worth developing also depends on the underlying worldview. So in the past worldviews, in the worldview of the past, if this world is itself seen as a temporary place and going to the next world is considered life's primary purpose, then putting too much energy into trying to improve this world was not considered a very worthwhile endeavor. But with the scientific revolution, more or less the other world related to the thought world of certain religious people only. And people started thinking, we have to create heaven in this world. So then all the human energy and ingenuity started being used to focus on trying to develop technology. And you know, wherever attention goes, energy flows. So because the attention of humanity in the last 2-3 centuries has been not on attaining some world beyond this world, but on improving this world, naturally we have developed technologies that are intended to improve the world. Now, how much the world has been improved, or which of the technologies have led to an improvement in an unadulterated way, which of the technologies have improved things in the short term but have created trouble in the long term, all these are serious issues that need to be discussed. So that would be the broad answer to that question.
Yes, bro. Second last question, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, as this is students from Bangalore, Prabhuji, as we are aware that the resources like water, etc., are almost created, got drained and used. But according to scripture, there are still 4 lakh years left in the living species still existing till then. So will Mars be the place where humans will be staying? Can you please explain on this?
Okay, that's a good question. So when we say that, so much of the human resources have been, so much water has been polluted, and we have so much shortage of vital resources for living, but there is many more years to live. So will we be going to Mars or some other planets and that's how humanity will continue? It's very difficult to know exactly how things will unfold in the future. What we do broadly know is that things in Kali Yuga go down, but it need not be that they go down linearly straight. It could be that things go down, then they go down very rapidly, and then we understand, you know, this level is not sustainable, and then they rise again, and then they again go down, then they rise. So the descent could even be cyclic rather than simply linear. So will humans go to other planets and colonize those planets? Well, we seem to be significantly far away from that. And although there is space research going on, the feverish excitement surrounding space research that was there in the 60s, that is not there. And most people now think that even if space research is successful, most people means, I would say, the financiers of scientific research, whether we will put in that much money to actually emigrate all of humanity to another planet, that's open to question. It seems not very likely in the immediate future. What is more likely is that human beings are made to be remarkably resilient. And this applies individually as well as collectively. Now, if you look at the life story of any human being who has been significantly successful, you will find that they have faced such difficulties, such adversities. You wonder what keeps them going. So, you know, we human beings have a remarkably resilient spirit. And that spirit comes from our spirituality. So what applies to resilience means? Resilience means that we are knocked down and we rise. So actually that resilience ultimately comes from our transcendence. Because as spiritual beings, we are not meant to be knocked down. We are meant to soar to incredible heights in our loving relationship with the Lord. So we may not know about that spiritual side of our life. And that's why we may be resilient in other directions. So, but resilience, the resilience of the human spirit is one of the most inspiring realities of humanity, of the human story, of human history. Now, not everybody has the same level of resilience, but we are a remarkably resilient species. And that is why, whether we take the scientific account of history or the Vedic account of history, we human beings have survived for thousands and thousands of years. For millennia, we have survived. Now, for each one of us to be existing, we can go back, and so many ancestors had to survive through so many dangers, so many diseases, so many invasions, so many natural calamities. It's actually, if we consider the sheer amount of distresses and disasters that befall humanity, it's amazing that even anyone has the spirit to continue living. Sometimes, you know, some people get depressed. And we may feel, oh, why is this person getting depressed? Actually, we shouldn't be shocked that people are getting depressed. We should be surprised how so many people are not depressed. Because life can be so difficult. Life can be so devastating. So the resilience of the human spirit is a remarkable and inspiring reality. And what applies to humanity individually also applies to humanity collectively. So the current pandemic has crippled the global economy. But still, you know, there are so many stories of inspiring human resilience, where people come together, people are doing research, people are trying to find out how to deal with this pandemic. So we need to recognize that, yes, we have developed certain technologies which have been very, very destructive to the environment, but the resilience of the human spirit will come forth and we will find some solutions for it. So maybe we will start using more eco-friendly methods of water harvesting, more sustainable methods of water harvesting, and various problems like that. So I would say that we need to hold back on dystopian or doomsday kind of prophecies. That firstly, we shouldn't undermine the resilience of the human spirit. And even if there is some kind of sudden downflow, some downward chart, it will rise again. And again, we'll move up and move forward. That's how things will move. So we don't have to, just because it's Kali Yuga and just because things are going wrong, we don't have to be disproportionately dismissive or pessimistic. Yes, a healthy amount of, healthy dose of reality and awareness of reality is important. But there's no need to be dystopian or have doomsday kind of ideas. Whatever problems come, you know, humanity is creative enough to deal with those problems. Of course, the problems come, we find some creative solution to the problem, and other problems come. And then we find some creative solutions to those problems, and then other problems come. Now this goes on and on through this creative tackling of problems that come, gradually humanity's spiritual intelligence awakens. And then we start thinking, you know, could there be a domain of reality where I don't have to go on repeatedly facing problems, dealing with problems? Isn't there something higher that I can achieve? And that is when the spiritual search will begin in earnest. So the human can be the story of the greatest human triumph. So the human resilience can help us to triumph over various problems that come at the worldly level. But when the human resilience is directed towards the pursuit of transcendence, then that can be the most inspiring story in that can lead to the most inspiring stories in human history. Okay.
Yes, Praji. Praji, the question is, what does it mean to raise consciousness practically? This is from the students of GGT, Pune.
Okay, what does it mean to raise consciousness? It basically means that we start finding happiness and meaning in higher things, not lower things. Say, for example, we get some delicious food to eat. And maybe there's a delicious cake and we take the cake and eat it ourselves. Well, there's some pleasure in that, but it is a very self-centered pleasure. But okay, I take a slice of the cake and I share it with others. And they become happy by sharing that cake. They also feel happy. And I feel happy that I was able to do something that gave them some pleasure. So this is an expanded consciousness. So there can be expansion of consciousness and there can be elevation of consciousness. Expansion is more or less horizontal. Horizontal means in the material domain. That means instead of thinking only of what things give me pleasure, I think also of what things give others pleasure. Or at least we start thinking more about how our actions affect others. So that's expansion in the horizontal domain. And that's also very important. You know, when there are many cases when people drive a car and they're hit and run. They knock somebody down on the car on the road and yes, they just go away just to save themselves. And that person who was victimized, if they had been taken to a rush to a hospital, first aid had been called, they might have survived, but then they suffer or die or they suffer permanent damage because they reached late. So we're not so conscious of the consequences of our actions. So expansion of our consciousness means in the world at the material level, also our actions have consequences. We recognize that. Elevation of consciousness means we recognize that there are higher realities also. That there is material reality and there is spiritual reality. That means I understand that people are not just physical creatures who need food, clothing, shelter. People are also spiritual beings who need meaning and purpose in their life, who long to love and be loved. And we see them as multidimensional beings. So elevation of consciousness means that we see people as people, not as tools for our pleasure, not simply physical creatures, but as multidimensional beings. And ultimately elevation of consciousness means we start perceiving the most elevated reality, that is Krishna. So by the practice of spirituality, both the expansion of consciousness and the elevation of consciousness can happen. And these two can also happen by other means. Generally, if we interact with people who are very socially conscious or socially responsible, so if you interact with people who are, say, social welfare workers, their consciousness is expanded. They're not thinking only of me and my family and that my immediate circle. They think of the community, they can think of the country. So by associating with them, our consciousness will also expand. You associate with one person who has like a tremendous nationalistic fervor and zeal, then we will be infused by that. That's expansion. If we associate with somebody who has tremendous spiritual zeal, our consciousness become elevated. So spirituality leads to both expansion and elevation of consciousness. And the more our consciousness becomes expanded and elevated, the more we start seeking pleasure in the things that also bring pleasure to others. And pleasure that is uplifting, not degrading. Say, when our consciousness is very shrunk, I take pleasure by taking away, I get pleasure by taking away the things that give pleasure to others. So I eat all the food and there's delicious food, there's nothing left for others. That's not very good. But I share food. That is good. But that's better. But imagine I develop some technology, I develop some agriculture by which I produce food. Then I can benefit so many people. So many things can apply. So many domains it can apply like that. So we use our profession, we use our talents to do something of value which benefits us and which benefits others, not just gives us, not just say somebody has musical ability. So that ability is what they have, but depending on their consciousness, somebody can use musical ability to write very sensually titillating songs, and they might get some pleasure by that. Others might also get some pleasure by that. But that pleasure neither expands their consciousness nor expands others' consciousness. It actually puts everybody in this own sensual domain. But if somebody with the ability of singing also has an elevated consciousness, then they, when they sing about Krishna, say they write spiritual songs, then what happens? They can inspire so many other people to sing about Krishna and to raise their consciousness toward Krishna. So basically we can say that the level of our consciousness can be seen in the things that we seek pleasure in. And the more expanded or elevated our consciousness is, the bigger are the ways in which we seek pleasure. And not only do the bigger the ways we seek pleasure, what happens is not only do we get pleasure, but others also get pleasure by that. Okay?
Yes, Prabhuji. There are still some questions, but your time.
Yes. So maybe next week when we have a session, we'll see how many questions are there on scripture. And if they don't have that many questions on scripture, we could take this also.
Scripture is already, Prabhuji, it is overflowing.
Yeah. And as I mentioned, many of the questions that you are asking, if you haven't got the answers over here, you can look at thespiritualscientist.com.
Yeah.
And you may find answers over there also.
Yeah, those two questions which I kept at the back, they were something which we can find there only. That's why I thought we can keep it at the last. So, fine, devotees, we are so happy to have Association of Chaitanya Charan Prabhu again. And next week also on Saturday, 2:30 p.m. Prabhuji, 2:30 to 4 p.m.
Yes.
2:30 p.m. we will be having Association of His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu on scriptures. So you can post your questions. Already we have got many questions. So still, if you have any questions, you can post it down there. And let us thank His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu for your, thank you, Prabhuji, for so many technical concepts. I was also not knowing so many things. Students are asking and you're responding. I am learning in between. So thank you so much, Prabhuji, for your kind association.
Thank you for your service. Thank you. Those are very thoughtful questions. And in all of you, I can see the level of your intelligence as well as the level of your spiritual sincerity. And that combination of an insightful intelligence and spiritual sincerity, they are two very powerful assets for you. And I hope that I am of some small service to you in your life journey. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
So any students have any more questions, you can post it on Prabhuji's website, which we had posted yesterday, which we'll be posting on the Telegram group also. So Prabhuji eventually keeps answering questions on his websites. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.